Amen. And so are y'all ready for the word of God now? Yes. Come. Let me just try this side. Right? Are y'all ready for the word of God now? Okay. Let me try this side now. Are y'all ready for the word of God now? Amen. It's really good to have Randall, our missions partner, here with us. Anyone interested in Thailand, Laos, Burma, Myanmar, go and see him. And, you know, just be a blessing to him. Also, right, you know, we've got a special friend of mine, Lipun, Doralyn. Lipun is my schoolmate in Penang. And so if you want to know what I was like before I became a Christian, talk to him. Okay, but Lipun, remember, we are friends, right? Okay, hey, this morning, the Word of God, right? And, you know, I'm just so excited about the Word of God. You know, as you guys know, right, we are, you know, our theme for this year is... Wow, that was a very quick response. Come on, our theme for this year is... Okay, imparting love, impacting lives. Come on, tell the person next to you, touch them on the back, not slap them on the back. Some of them got back problems, right? Just touch them and say, imparting love, impacting lives. And so, right, you know, a year of transformation, so we're just doing this series over this. I think Pastor Mike spoke a great word last week. And, you know, and so this, I just want to challenge you guys, right? You know, our whole goal in life is to be like, let me say this again, right? Our whole goal in life is to be like? Jesus. Okay, Jesus. And, you know, of course, right, there are many scriptures about this. You know, the Bible says, right, in Philippians 1:21, the scripture speaks about, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, the Bible says, we are transformed into His image, right? And so, are you being changed into His image? That means, right, and I've not seen you for two Sundays, right? Are we more like Jesus now than 2 weeks ago? Okay, are we like, you know, being like Jesus? Are we more, you know, we speak, are we, our speech, right? Is it more like Christ now? And so, right, you know, it's something that you and I need to journey. Why? Because, you know, as we will look next week, right, our whole journey in life is, come on, someone say this, change, change, change. Wow, that was a good response, you guys. Anyway, come on, our whole journey in life is change, change, change. And so we are transformed. You know, as we see, right, you know, the truths of God's word, allow the word of God to change us. And then, right, we are transformed into His very image. Amen. And so we are here, right, just to, we are just here to be more like Jesus. Amen. And so this whole area of imparting love, impacting lives, a year of transformation. Amen. And so we need to ask ourselves some questions. You know, have we imparted love this week? Amen. Have we impacted any lives this week? Amen. You know, have we, right, even this week, right, or over these few weeks, right, you know, have there been people, right, that as a result of meeting us, they say, I want to be like, I want what you have. And so this is something that we need to look at. And, you know, of course, right, you know, many of you will be celebrating your family reunions this week. You know, it's just a great opportunity for us, right, to connect. And for us, right, to be a blessing, and for us, right, even this morning, right, to proclaim Jesus. Amen. This morning, we're going to look at a very familiar portion of Scripture, a wonderful, an amazing account, a powerful miracle that Jesus did. And we're going to look at Mark chapter 1, verses 40 to 45. We're just going to read a few verses, and then, right, we're going to look at, you know, we're going to look at just two questions that we need to ask ourselves, right? The first question, how can I connect with God and receive my blessing? And the second question is, how can I connect with people so that they may be blessed? Amen. And so, right, you know, how do I connect with God? So this is in line, right? Remember the greatest commandment which all of us should have memorized. In Mark 12, 30 and 31, what does it say? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And so, right, our whole journey in life is just simple, right? Jesus summed up everything, love God and love people. Amen. You know, you and I cannot say, well, Pastor, I love God, but I can't stand that person, right? But that's not, you know, you don't work that way. Amen. Why? Because, you know, I remember some years ago, right, you know, when I was in JB, right, you know, trying to sort out an issue. You know, one of them said, you know, they had a bit of an argument, two of them. And then, right, you know, one of them, you know, and then I told them, right, you know, Christians, we need to forgive. And so got them both together. They said, we forgive. And then one of them said this, Pastor, I forgive, but I will never talk to that person again. So, an adult, right, behaving like a child in the playground. Okay, but that's not how it is, right? We love God, and then we love people, and that's what it is, right? And today, right, you know, as we look at this journey through Mark chapter 1, verses 40 to 40, especially verses 40 to 42, right? Remember, right, you know, how God wants us to connect. How God wants us to connect with Him. And then as a result, right, receive that blessing, receive that miracle. How God wants us to connect with people. And, you know, we connect with people the way Jesus connects with them. Amen. How many of you want to improve your communication skills? Nobody wants to improve their communication skills. Come on. How many of you want to improve your communication skills? Okay. I'm sure you go to many seminars, go to leadership teams. Some of you pay a lot of money, right, for seminars. But let me tell you, the Bible. Amen. And the greatest communicator, the master communicator, the communicator above every communicator, His name is Jesus Christ Himself, right? Amen. And you know, and this morning, right, we're going to look at this portion of scripture. And as we look at this, right, let's draw some principles here. Amen. And so how do you connect? It's about connect, right? Come on, tell the person that you connect. Life is about connect, right? And everything is about connect. And you know, how do we connect with God? And how do we, as a result of that, receive that blessing or that miracle, right? Okay, the Bible says here, now a leper came to Him, imploring Him, kneeling down to Him and saying to Him, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Okay, some principles for us to take note. Amen. You know, leprosy, right, is like, leprosy is probably the most horrible disease, right? Especially during the Bible times. Once you get it, that's it. Of course, right, there have been few miracles in the Bible in leprosy, Naaman, the leper. And also, right, you know, during Jesus' time, Jesus healed, right, the leper here. And Jesus also healed 10 lepers in the book of Luke as well. And so, right, you know, it's a terrible disease. You know, there are certain principles about leprosy. You know, it's really, right, speaks about sin. It really speaks about, you know, some of the struggles that we go through. You know, when you and I, you know, when we are getting bitter, or sometimes, right, you're battling an illness, or you're battling, right, a financial crisis, or you're battling, right, a certain habit in your life. Amen. And so, right, these are principles, right, that, you know, really affect, right, across the board. Amen. You know, the first thing is, you know, as you look at leprosy and as you look at some of the sin, you know, it starts small and it grows bigger. You know, it always starts, you know, for leprosy, it starts like a red dot and then, right, it grows. And, you know, and sometimes in sin or things that we are involved in, right, it starts small and then it gets bigger and bigger. That's why, right, we've got to address issues as quick as possible. The second thing about leprosy and about sin is that it isolates. You know, those that have leprosy in those days, they were isolated, right? They were thought as a curse. You know, at that point of time, right, you know, really people had this thinking that, you know, if you are sick or you've got leprosy, you've got a real big sin problem, right? And so this was the idea, right, the Pharisees and the Sadducees had. And so, and everybody that was sick, right, you know, it's because, right, they've got a sin problem and they deserve it. And so as a result of that, right, you know, there was a curse upon those that were lepers. And so a leper, right, had a very miserable life. That means, right, he went about, he had a set of clothes that, you know, speaks about, you know, how, right, you know, it's like death clothes over him. You know, he had to go, he had to declare, I'm unclean. People kept the distance from him. And so it isolates. And, you know, and so many times in life, right, where we battle sin, or we battle sicknesses, or we battle businesses, or maybe, right, struggling with issues in our life, struggling with acceptance. You know, so many times, right, in life, as a result of this, right, you know, it isolates. You know, a lot of times, right, when, you know, when people, right, sin or do, you know, they want to isolate themselves, right? And so, right, we need to discern this. The third thing about leprosy is it enslaves, right? You know, it hits you and then it enslaves you and you become a slave. And it's like everything else in life, right? A habit, right? You touch it and then it grows and then it isolates and then, right, it enslaves. And, you know, sin as well, it's the same. And then, right, also, right, you know, another thing about leprosy is it destroys. And, you know, and this goes with sin, and, you know, everything else it destroys. And so, right, as you look at this, right, these are principles, and, you know, the leper was there. and he was really struggling in his life. But what did he do, right? How did he connect with Jesus and receive the blessing? You see, this morning, right, it's about connect. Amen. This morning, right, it's about how we can love God as with all our hearts, our soul, our minds, and our strength, and love people. Love our neighbor as ourselves. And so, right, you know, our whole life revolves around relationships. Our relationship with God, and then our relationship with others. You know, and everything in life, right, speaks about, you know, the call of Moses, the call of Isaiah. It speaks about, right, restoring our relationship with God. Amen. And then, right, you know, a call, right, a commission to go out. And as you look at the life of Jesus as well, amen, you know, he encourages us, right, to come to him. And then, right, he asks us to go out as fishers of men. And so, right, you know, how does this leper connect with God and receive his blessing? Amen. And so, right, how do we receive a miracle? You know, as you look at this, get the scripture up. Amen. As you look at this, right, you know, the Bible says this, imploring him, kneeling down to him, saying to him, if you're willing, you can make me clean. Few things here, right? If you and I want to connect with God in such a way to receive a blessing, I think there are three areas here mentioned. Firstly, right, there was a desperation. Amen. We need to be desperate people, right? And then, right, you know, he realized, right, you know, there was no one else that could help him except Jesus. And so, right, you know, as you look at some of the words, right, imploring him, kneeling down to him, saying to him, if you're willing, you can make, you know, it speaks about words of a desperate man that needed a touch, a miracle touch. You know, for him, as for him, right, you know, his whole life was hopeless and helpless. Amen. And he needed, he probably heard about what Jesus was doing. And he was, you know, positioning himself, coming before him. Desperation, that we need to get desperate, right? You know, it's interesting, right? As you look at this, amen. Although, right, he had a physical condition, you know, he was asking God to make him clean. You see, right now, desperate, you know, not just, right, for his outward condition or his physical condition, but desperate, right, for a restoration of his spiritual condition. You know, church, you know, so many times, right, we get desperate for the outward, right, the natural. But you see, right, you and I need to get desperate, right, for the spiritual. Because it is the spiritual that affects, right, the natural. It is the spiritual, right, that affects, right, the physical. And you and I need, if you sort out the spiritual, if you sort out the inward issue, right, the outward issue, right, will follow as a result of that. And so this man, right, you know, he was desperate, right, that he wanted to worship God like the way other people could worship. Remember, he was isolated. And so he was really desperate, right, for worship, right? He was desperate, right, for fellowship. He was desperate. And so, right, this morning, right, we got to be desperate, right? Amen. A cry of desperation. Another thing that you can see here, right, as you look at this scripture, it is a cry of humility, right? Come on, church. Amen. You know, it was a cry, right, of a man, right, not just desperate, but a man, right, that was humble, right, that he was kneeling down. You know, I think the NIV uses, or the NLT uses the word begging, right? And so he was really desperate. He was kneeling down, right? When you kneel down, right, you know, before, you know, you are saying, right, that you are higher than me, right? I'm desperate. I'm humble before you. And as a result of that, right, you know, we need to humble ourselves. You know, it speaks about, right, a man, not just desperate, but a man that was humble. A man, right, that was dependent, right? A man, right, that needed a miracle. You know, one of the biggest, right, obstructions, amen, to receive a miracle is our pride. You and I, right, you know, sometimes want it our way, right? You and I, right, you know, sometimes feel as though, right, God owes this to me, right? You know, you and I, right, you know, sometimes, you know, we are not humble enough to receive. And, you know, and if you and I want to be, right, at the point where, you know, we are experiencing, right, the goodness of God, we need to be humble. You know, if you look at 2 Kings chapter 5, you know, and here, right, was the story of Naaman, the other leper. You know the story of Naaman. And, you know, and here, right, you know, Naaman gets leprosy. And, you know, of course, right, you know, praise God for a maid, right, that had a relationship with God. And, you know, and she said, listen, you know, you can experience a healing, right? That's a prophet, amen, that God has anointed to heal. And, of course, right, you know, you all know the story. He makes this journey. And then as he comes to where Elisha was, you know, what does the Bible say, right? You know, Elisha just gives an instruction, right? Elisha does not meet him. Elisha, right, now this was maybe the number two, number three guy in the Syrian Empire. Elisha, right, sits in his house and he just gives a message that, you know, you need to wash yourself seven times in the River Jordan. And so, right, you know, when Naaman hears this, what does the Bible say, right? You know, the Bible says he was really upset, right? And here, no, he was a great man. And he was a great man, you know, he was, right, you know, one of the most powerful men on earth. Amen. And here he was, right, and you know what he said, right? You know, how can this prophet, right, Elisha, not even greet me, right? You know, how could this prophet, right, not just, right, in the car, you know, he could have just come out, right, and waved his hands at me, right? And yet, right, you know, he just asks me to wash in the River Jordan. Come on, are there, you know, isn't there better rivers to wash in Syria? Even more cleaner rivers than these muddy waters of Jordan. And so, right, his pride almost became, right, an obstruction for his healing. Amen. Can I hear an amen? Amen. You know, his pride, right, you know, the way that he wanted the healing, the way, right, he wanted God to answer. You know, some of us, right, you know, the way, right, listen, really almost became a hindrance. Then one of his servants said to him, you know, the Bible says, right, Father, and he says, you know, and the servant says this, right, you know, if the prophet, right, told you to do great things, right, won't you have done great things, right? And so the guy said, I'm a great man. If the prophet said great things, right, I will do great things. And then, right, you know, and here, right, the prophet just asks you just to wash in the river. And of course, right, you know, somehow then he realized, amen. And so, right, you know, he went to this river. And so he dips the first time. What happens? Come on, someone say nothing happened. You know, sometimes you feel as though, right, you know, you're doing things right, going to church, right, and then, right, you know, you're just, right, you know, doing things, right, giving your tithes, right, you know, loving, going for cell group, and nothing happens, right? And then, right, he dips the second time. What happens? Somebody say nothing happens. Did the third time. Fourth time. Fifth time. Fifth time, right, getting up and seeing, right, you know, looking at his hand, same leprosy. Amen. You know, is this prophet making me a fool? Amen. And then he goes sixth time. And the seventh time, right, he comes out. His skin is completely healed. You see, right, you know, and sometimes, right, God has got to put us down. You know, sometimes, right, God has got to allow things in our life, right, to deal. Why? Because, you know, sometimes, right, it is not just the outward, but it's a heart issue that we need to deal with. And, you know, and the leper was spot on. Amen. You know, he had a healing issue. You know, he needed a miracle, but he was spot on. He said, God, cleanse me. And he was willing to humble himself. And, you know, and of course, right, and so many times we need to humble ourselves, right? The first time, right, you know, the Naaman had to humble himself. Second time, humble himself. Third time, humble himself. God was molding him. Why? Because he needed to understand, right, you know, you got to obey the word of God. You got to humble yourself. And then the seventh time he received his healing. Come on, church, listen, you need to, you know, sometimes, right, you know, when, you know, the first time you ask and you don't receive, and someone says, what kind of God is this? You know, see, right, you know, pastor, you know, that person, right, has this miracle, this person, look at me. And then, but you got to keep in the process, right? You got to keep asking. You got to keep in the process. You got to keep depending. You got to keep in the process, and you got to keep humbling ourselves. And then seventh time this guy got healed. You know, this leper here, he said, right, you know, he came to him, imploring him, kneeling down to him and saying to him, you're willing, you can make me clean. Humble. The cry of humility, right? Come on, church, it's a cry of humility. It's a cry of desperation. It's a cry, right, of faith. You know, what did he say, right? If you are willing, you, come on, if you are willing, you can. Come on, say this, you can. You can. Come on, say this louder. Come on, this side. Let me try this side. You can. You can. Now the right side. You see, right? You got to have, right, the cry of faith, right? Amen. You see, right? This is not going to work, right? You know why? Because it is faith. In God's operating principle, it's faith. You got to have this. God, you can. You know, each one of us, come on, look at me. Each one of us, right? You've got to have this mentality in our head that God is able. Amen. When you battle, right, your circumstances, maybe, right, you're in a situation where you're battling acceptance. You got to say, God is able. You got to have this God is able. You got to cry out to God, right? Maybe this morning, right, you're sitting here and experiencing, right, a sickness issue, right? Sometimes, a lot of you are in ministry, you know, sometimes, right, it is not the sickness that destroys the person. It's the fear. It's the intimidation, right, that, you know, paralyze the person, right, so that the guy is just in fear and doubt, right, and cannot operate in faith, right? And so you got to have this, right? Come on, church, you got to have this mindset that God is able, right? You know, issues in your work, right? If you want to see, right, a miracle, you want to see God come through, you got to have this mindset that God is able. Amen. You know, impossible is possible. Come on, tell the person next to you. Impossible is possible, right? Amen. That means, right, whatever, you've got to have this. And here, right, when this leper looked at, you know, when the leper looked at Jesus, he said, if you're willing, you can. You can. You can. It was a cry of faith. What is it, right? What is the need that we have? Amen. You know, what is the struggle? You know, some, it's a personal need, family need, whatever, right? You know, if you and I want to connect with Jesus, if you and I want to position ourselves to receive that miracle, come on, church, this morning, right? It has got to be a cry of desperation, a cry of humility, and a cry of faith. Amen. And then we receive. You see, right, you know, and then, right, you know, you see what happens, right? How does Jesus respond? Jesus will always, come on, Jesus will always respond to a desperate cry. Amen. Jesus, right, the Bible says, right, whoever touched Jesus was made well. Jesus will hear the faintest cry. Jesus will hear the loudest cry. Jesus will hear, right, you know, any cry. Jesus will hear any need, right? And as this, right, as you look at Jesus, how does he respond? And then, you know, how, right, you know, here, right, we learn, right, the principles of connection, you know, from Jesus. How does Jesus respond? The Bible says this. The Bible says that, you know, in Mark 1:41, then Jesus moved with compassion. Come on, just take note of this. Why? Because this is the art of communicating well. Amen. You know, these are principles, right, that we look at the way Jesus does, and then we become more like him. Amen. That means, right, we love God with all our hearts and love our neighbor as ourselves. And so the Bible says, right, then Jesus moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, I'm willing, be cleansed. Four amazing, you know, principles of connection here. And look at this, right? You know, the first thing that the Bible says, right, compassion. What's compassion? You know, compassion, right, is you and I, right, have a, you know, we feel sympathy, right, for a person that's going through a crisis. And there's also, right, not just you feel sympathy for a person going through a crisis, but you also have a strong desire to help that person. Can I hear an amen? Amen. And so, right, it's about feeling. Amen. It's about, you know, just feeling sympathy. You know, sometimes we use the word pity. You know, you feel, right? And then, right, there's a strong desire for us to help. And as you look at compassion, right, you know, the Bible says he was moved with compassion. And so it starts with the heart. You see, right, everything that God does in our life starts with the heart. Right? You know, the Bible says out of the abundance of our mouth, you know, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, right? You see, right, everything that we face, right, it's a heart thing. That's why, right, you know, earlier on, right, the leper said, you know, cleanse me. Why? Because it's a heart issue. Amen. It's the spiritual that must affect. And so compassion is a heart issue, right? And then, right, you know, what does Jesus do here, right? You know, another principle of connection is that, you know, Jesus stretches out his hand and touches him, right? Touch. The power of touch. A touch that transforms. You know, sometimes, right, you know, we do, right, going around shaking hands. Right, you know, every week we do Sunday. It's a powerful principle, right? Amen. A powerful principle. Amen. That, you know, you shake hands, but, you know, it's the principle of touch. And for this leper, right, can you imagine, right, all through his life, no one has ever touched him. You know, probably the only person that touched him was his mother, right? When he discovered leprosy, then he would be completely, right, excluded from society. And here, right, you know, when Jesus touched him, it was a touch of transformation. It was a touch, right, of acceptance. You know, Jesus, when he touched him, right, when Jesus touched him, he says this, right? In his touch, right? The non-verbal communication that's going on. I love you as you are. You know, when Jesus, right, touched him, I accept you as you are. You know, I love you. And, you know, my desire is to see, right, you know, God's plan fulfilled in your life. And then I will heal you, right? And so, right, you know, this whole area of the principle of touch, the principle and compassion is to do with the heart. The touch is to do with your body. You see, right, you know, you and I cannot love and say, Pastor, I've got such great compassion. Such great compassion. See, for example, such great compassion for the Vietnamese, right? God's given me a burden. And we sit down here and do nothing. Compassion compels you, right, for action, right? Amen. Come on, say this, right? Compassion compels us for action, right? And so that action, right, is revealed, right, by the touch. You got to go and touch. You got to get near, right? And, you know, and for Jesus and for this man, right, you know, in the minds of the Pharisees and Sadducees, they're breaking the law. But you see, you know, sometimes, right, we are obedient to the law, but our ultimate submission is to the Almighty God. And so when there are laws, right, that are not in submission to God, then, right, we submit to God. And here, right, you know, Jesus, right, stretched out and he touched. Amen. And, you know, and for this man, right, you know, the healing process that started, right, it was not just heart, compassion. It was not just touch, body, right. It was also words, the mouth. What did Jesus say? You know, Jesus said to him, I am willing, be cleansed. Amen. And so, right, you know, Jesus was declaring his will. I'm willing. You know, Jesus was declaring, right, words of power, be cleansed. He had the authority to speak it. And as a result of this, right, this man experienced, right, this miracle. And then in verse 42, right, the Bible says, as soon as Jesus had spoken, the Bible says immediately the leprosy left him and he was cleansed. And the fourth thing, right, which the world does not know, is the power of God. You see, right, you know, you and I as Christians, you know, the Bible says in Ephesians 3, I said, right, we need to have a God is able mindset. Come on, tell the person next to you, you need to have a God is able mindset. You know, Ephesians 3:20, God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that's in you. You know, you see, right, as Christians, you know, anyone, right, you know, compassion, heart. And then, right, the touch, the body, right? And then there's the words, the mouth. And then, right, you know, for us, right, we have the power. It's God, right? No, we have vehicles, right, to connect. You know, you and I, right, are empowered by the Spirit of God just to do. Right? And for this man, right, as he was positioned here, what happened, right? You know, he experienced the miracle touch of God. But but the story doesn't stop there, right? You see, right, you know, so many times, right, God does a miracle for another miracle. You see, right, you know, so many times there's a purpose, but there's a bigger purpose. And, you know, and so many times, right, you know, this time as I was preparing this, you know, somehow, right, you know, we end, you know, our story at Mark chapter 1, verse 42. And we say, wow, God, what a great healing, right? God, Jesus, you healed the leper. And, you know, and twice Jesus healed lepers in the Gospels. And here, right, we stop there, right? But you see, the story does not stop there. You and I must know, right, in our hearts, right, the miracle, you know, the purpose for miracles, you know, is that, you know, that miracle itself must bring a greater revelation of Jesus. And that miracle itself, right, must impact lives, right? Amen. You see, right, the wedding of Cana, first miracle, water turned to wine. And then as a result of that, the Bible says people believed. You know, a few weeks ago, we did Fresh Fire, Acts chapter 3. Amen. Jesus, Peter and John walk into the temple. Silver and gold have I none, but what I have, I give unto you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Powerful miracle. And yet, right, that miracle was the basis for another miracle, right? If you look at Mark chapter 1, verse 44. What does the Bible say? And what did Jesus say to him? And Jesus wanted him to be focused. And Jesus said that you say nothing to anyone, but go your way. Show yourself to the priest. Show yourself to the priest. And offer your cleansing offer your cleansing, those things which Moses commanded, as a testimony to them. Offer your cleansing as a testimony to them. You see, right, you know, there is a miracle that takes place. But you know, God, you know, God's interested in miracles, but God has a higher miracle, right? The salvation of people. As a result of this miracle, right, the priests were informed, right? And then they began to realize at this stage that Jesus was the Messiah. Why? Because he healed the leper. And, you know, and they had realized that Jesus had the power. Amen. That Jesus, you know. And here, right, this miracle was an instrument, amen, for, you know, for us, right, to proclaim Jesus and to impact lives. You know, some of us know, right, in Acts, remember Paul. Paul and Silas were in Philippi, I think Acts chapter 16, right? And, you know, and when they were in 16, right, you know, some of you know that he was doing ministry in Philippi. You know, people were getting saved. The demon-possessed girl, you know, got set free. The owners got upset. They threw him in prison. And what was Paul and Silas doing in prison? You know, the Bible says they were praising. They were singing praises. They were singing praises to God. And as they were doing that, you see, right, you know, how can you sing praises in a prison? You need to know, right, there's a higher purpose. Amen. You know, yes, you know, you need to know, right, you know, yes, you know, you may not understand why, he may not have understood why he was in prison, but he knew that there was a high purpose. And some of us know, right, then the miracle took place, there's an earthquake took place, right? And, you know, as a result of that, the prison doors opened. And what did Paul and Silas do? What did he do? What did they do, right? And here, right, probably all the other prisoners bolted. But you see, right, you know, Paul knew, right, there's a higher purpose. And that higher purpose was, you know, as he was coming out, he saw, he saw the jailer, and the jailer was going to kill himself. Why? Because that will be the consequence of a prison break, right? The jailer will die. And, you know, and amidst this, right, you see a choice that Paul had to make. You know, yes, you know, he could have, right, freedom and walk out, escape, freedom. And yet, right, Paul realized the higher purpose. There was a man to be saved, right? And the Bible says, I think Acts 16, verse 21, the Bible says, right, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you and your family will be saved, right? And as a result of that, the Bible says, right, the jailer got saved, his family got saved, and a vibrant church started in Philippi. Church, you know, why am I sharing this, right? You see, right, you know, how do we connect? We need to connect with God to receive our blessing, right? And, you know, the way Jesus operates to connect with people, we need to connect with people as well. But you see, right, the higher purpose in all this, when God does something in your life, you know, when God gives you a blessing, why does God give you a blessing? Yes, you know, to meet our need, right? But there's always a higher purpose, that it may be a testimony, right, we need to declare. And we need to speak this, right? You know, this morning, right, I just want to say this, right, God is limitless in his power. Get the worship team up. You know, God is, you know, sovereign. You know, God is able to do anything, right? And this morning, right, all he's looking for us, right, and, you know, in our lives is that, you know, that you and I will just make ourselves available, right? You know, each one of us may be going through our various challenges in our life. Each one of us, you know, sometimes our challenges may not be our own personal, right, challenges, right, for the people around. You know, some of us, right, may be in situations that we just need to have the wisdom of God, right, to deal with situations. And God is there for us, right? He's the God of wisdom. He's able, right? You know, some of us, right, maybe, right, you know, things, right, they say, right, the property market is down. And, you know, there have been a lot of things that are happening around. Amen. But, you know, you and I need to have wisdom. Why? Because we need to have that mentality that God is able. Come on, he can. Come on, stand up with me. He can. He can. And, you know, and this morning, right, I want to really challenge each one of us, amen, wherever we are, right, we're going to call upon that name. Right? We're going to call upon that name. Right? Hallelujah. The God that healed the leper is the God that's in our midst. Can I hear an amen? Amen. The God, right, that walked, amen, the God that, you know, set free, right, Paul and Silas in prison is the God that's in our midst. Amen. And, you know, and it's always, right, there's always a higher purpose. There is the touch of God, and there's also the higher purpose. Amen. Hallelujah. Father God, that even this morning, as we come before you, Lord, we ask, Father God, that even today, Lord, even as we've looked at this portion of Scripture, Lord Jesus, we ask you to confirm your word, Lord, with the accompanying signs. Lord, we pray, Father God, that even today, Lord, that even as we call, even as we sing that beautiful name, and that powerful name of Jesus. Hallelujah. God, that even as we declare, Lord, I ask, Father God, that even today, God, that you'll visit us. Amen. Come on, church, are you ready for a fresh touch of God? Hello? Are you ready this morning? Amen. Are you ready, right? Is there something that you want to receive this morning, right? And as I always say, right, you know, we've got to be specific, right? We've got to ask God, right? God, amen. This morning I've come. You know, church is not just, right, Sunday attendance, right? Church is, right, for us to worship, great worship, right? For church, but also is, right, for us to experience the greatness of God. Amen. The goodness of God. And this morning, right, wherever we are, we're going to declare this. Amen. And even as we declare this, right, I want you to worship, right? As we sing and declare His name. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Are y'all ready this morning? Amen. Amen. You know, I want you guys to just lift up your hands and say, God, I'm ready, right? Amen. God, I need a touch, Lord. I need a touch, Lord. I need a touch. Amen. I need a touch. He's a God that's compassionate, right? He's a God that stretches out His hand. He's a God that speaks, right, healing. He's a God that heals. Hallelujah. Amen. He's a God, right? As you look at this miracle, it was more than a healing miracle, right? It was a restoration of a spiritual condition. It was a cleansing. Amen. You know, it was a cleansing. It was a cleansing. It was a restoration of relationship. Amen. God gives us, right? And God dealt with that. And then, you know, there was also a healing, right? Two supernatural results taking place in these five scriptures. And as a result of that, another supernatural result. Amen. How, right? This man, amen, shared the testimony of Jesus. And only God knows, right, how many other lives would have been touched. What's your, this morning, right, you know, just cry out to Him, you know, wherever you are, right? His name, His name. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says, the name of Jesus is above every other name, that every knee shall bow and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, the name of Jesus, hallelujah. The Bible says, right, you know, even as we ask in His name, His name, the name of Jesus, you know, the Bible says, right, it shall be done if it's according to His will. Amen. His name. Amen. Right through this morning, right, we have been worshiping with the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Wonderful name. Amen. Jesus, come on, lift your voices right now and call upon that name wherever you are, right? Make this an altar. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, cry out to God this morning. Hallelujah. Wherever you are, come on, church. Hallelujah. Amen. Cry out with desperation. Cry out, right, even this morning, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus. Oh, a desperate cry, Lord. Hallelujah. God, even this morning, Lord, divine intervention. Cry out, right? Cry out in humility. Tell the Lord this morning, right? God, not my way, but your way. You know, and so many times, Lord, my pride has been an hindrance, amen, to you working in my life and in my situation. Come on, this morning, right? You know, this morning, present yourself. Come before Him in humility, right? You know, some of us, right, think we have all the answers for our life. Come on, you know, that's pride, right? We do not have answers for our life. Only God has answers for our life. And even this morning, right, you know, we need to begin, right, not to focus on ourselves, but focus on God. Come on, this morning, His breakthrough morning. This morning, right, is a healing morning. This morning, right, God wants to take you to the next level. Hallelujah. Cry out in desperation. Cry out this morning. Hallelujah. Cry out in humility. Hallelujah. Come on, church. Amen. God may have ways of bringing your miracle that may be very different from what you want. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, many years ago, right, you know, some time ago, ministering, right, at a meeting. And, you know, and as we were praying for this person, you know, and this person said, oh, pastor, I've got problems here, everywhere, right? You know, back here, front, everywhere, right, problems. You know, my whole life was a problem. And I said, God, how can we sort this out, right? You know, I said, right, you know, this lady's got problems all over. And then, right, the Lord gave me a word, right, ask her, right, whether she's got unforgiveness. And I said, right, you know, sister, do you have unforgiveness? And, you know, and she rudely replied to me, right, what has that got to do with my problem? I said to her, right, like, that's got to do everything with your problem, right? Why? Because, you know, some of this stuff, right, like unforgiveness, amen, is like the rubbish dump, right, that attracts the flies, the rats, and everything else that you can see, right? Amen. And so, right, and I told her, right, you know, and of course, right, she refused, right? You see, right, you know, God wanted to address a spiritual condition. Amen. So that she can have a physical miracle. And she refused, right? She went back with all her pain. Amen. Why? Because you see, right? You know, pride, right? You know, sometimes pride, right, is a hindrance, right, to God's move in our life. Come on, church, you know, you and I, right, got to be humble. All of us, right, you know, have all kinds of, you know, all of us have some form of pride, and we need to humble ourselves, right? We need to be desperate. And come on, church, this morning, right, we need to cry out in faith. Amen. You got to cry out in faith. Amen. You know, this morning, come on, church, look at me. Like, you know, some of the scriptures, right, needs to be in our head and our heart, right, and our mouth. Like, amen. Come on. Head, heart, and mouth, right? You know, with God, all things are possible, right? When you battle, right, a sickness, amen, you got to look at it. The devil says, right, it's this or that, right? The devil says you're going down. And you need to say, with God, all things are possible, right? When you're battling a sickness, right? Or maybe, right, the devil says, right, you know, listen, right, you know, and you and I, right, have got great, you know, sometimes you've got great thought processes, right? One fear leads another fear, another fear, another fear, right? And as a result of that, right, you know, people just miss the miracle. You know, sometime ago, ministering to this guy, right? You know, I asked to go and pray for him. And you know, as we walked into this, his house, right, he was sitting there in the chair. I said, right, what's wrong? He said, you know, Pastor, I've got very, very high blood pressure. And then I said, okay, we can pray for this, right? And then he said this to me, Pastor, you know, my grandfather had very high blood pressure and he died. And then he said, right, my uncle had very high blood pressure and he died. And then he said, right, my father had high blood pressure and he died. And the doctors have just told me I've got high blood pressure, right? And he said, right, he's going to die. And then so, right, we prayed for him that morning. And you see, right, you know, sometimes our mindset, come on, you and I, right, have this so negative mindset of fear, right? We've got to ask God to change, right? You know, you got to begin to think, right, the way Jesus thinks, right? You and I, right, have got to have a God is able mindset, right? Each one of us, as you battle challenges in your life, amen, as you deal, right? You know, one of the hardest things in life is to deal with personal issues in our life. And when God speaks to us, right, and we just say, you know, don't. Why? Because, you know, if you don't deal, right, remember principle of leprosy, you know, what starts small will grow bigger and bigger and bigger. It's better to nip it in the bud and deal with it immediately, right? You know, whatever it may be, right, a habit, an unforgiveness or whatever, right? You know, sometimes people struggle with acceptance. You know, sometimes people struggle, right? You know, this world is just me. Come on, this is not the world. Now, this is not right what the Bible says. The Bible says love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. It's not about me, it's about others. Amen. And we've got this whole mindset, right, of just me, right? You know, what I feel like, what I like, right? And come on, it's a bondage, right, that will never, man, it is a bondage, right? This whole area of self-centeredness, it will never see, right, you know, God come through, right? Come on, church, can we do that? We're going to sing this.